your name on it. Just put your name on it. That's all I say. Be a man or a woman. Put your name on it.
Well, I'd like to hear about it, potheads.
How the fuck you gonna know how to be great if you don't study greatness? Look at the game change.
Donuts.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, you know, you got a bad looking man, Mr. Gal.
But you are, Blanche. You are in that chair.
There's something wrong with us. Something very, very wrong with us.
Oh, hey, buddy. Oh, yeah.
Never say whoops. I'm new at this live read game, and I read some guy's blog, like, Joe Rogan and Mark Maron, they do theirs up front. Jake tries to weave them in the middle, and it's horrible. So now I'm just doing them in the beginning so everybody can just relax and have a good time.
Warriors, what's up? It's your boy, me, JJ, Jay Moore, and I'm excited, extremely excited to tell you about my new smarter home security, Simply Safe. I didn't think home security could be this easy. I've wanted a system to protect my home for years, but it's always been a real pain in my ass. Alarm companies, it's always the same old story. Aggressive sales guys, ridiculous hardwire systems, the long-term lock-in contract. I would never sign one. I didn't have one. But now my house is safe. Simply Safe. Simply with an I. S-I-M-P-L-I. Simply Safe has my house on lockdown. People come to my door. The front yard gets lit up like an operating room, and they hit the deck. I can't tell you how easy this is. I went online, customized my system. A few days later, boom, it's at my doorstep. And I'm not a tech guy at all, but I swear they helped me get it up and running in 20 minutes. Best part, no contract at all. Around-the-clock protection, $15. Most guys charge three times that, and I can leave this deal whenever I want. Like I said, no contract. I can tap out whenever I want, but I'm not gonna, because Simply Safe is great. I am positive that I'm sticking with Simply Safe. If you guys want to have the exact same protection as me at the fake mustache studio house, it's so easy. Go to SimplySafeJ.com. Simply is S-I-M-P-L-I, safe. SimplySafeJ.com. You'll get an exclusive 10% off. It's only 15 bucks, and they're still going to take 10% off. SimplySafeJ.com.
Nick Swardson in the house. What you going to do? Go AWOL.
Tramp stamp. .net. That's mine. That's my website. Trampstamp.org.
Trampstamp. Now, you had a first with net. Don't second guess yourself. Nicholas!
Hello.
You're the strongest boy in the world.
Yes. How are you?
My wife.
I did that to somebody the other day. I go, I'm doing a new character. They're like, what is it? And I go, it's called Borat. And they're like, what? And I go, my wife. Like, oh, it's like Borat. I'm like, no, but mine's different. Like, I know it's the same fucking thing. I'm like, no, it's not.
I'm not an idiot. I wouldn't do Borat. This is Borat.
It's Borat, man.
My wife, she's gandy.
It's way different.
I like to think Borat is B-O-R-T, not B-R-I-T. That was in your mind, right?
Yeah.
I like Bort.
It's Bort.
It's a Bort.
His name is Bort.
Nicholas, you and I, first of all, is Pretend Time on Amazon? Can people buy it?
Yeah, it's on Netflix. The show will no longer exist.
Whoa, explosive. Hot off the presses.
I mean, yeah. The show was great. The ratings were fine.
Did it get canceled?
No, the ratings were fine. We just, like, I just couldn't really deal with it anymore. It was a lot. Doing a one-man sketch show, nobody's really done that where it was just all on their shoulders. And
it,
like,
seems stressful to get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to do Gay Robot for 4 minutes and go home.
Yeah, I wish.
I love Gay, like, Robot more than maybe anything on television other than Honey Boo Boo.
Yeah, Gay Robot and Honey Boo Boo should team up, make a sex tip.
Where's your father with the dip of Kodiak in his mouth? I have some skull long cut for him.
I've got some long cut for him to dip on.
Oh, my God. So you just didn't want to do it anymore?
Yeah, it was an expensive show, and we just... It was just, I just didn't want to do it. I had a new idea. I have a new show I'm developing. And I kind of wanted to produce that.
Bort?
It's called Bort. And it's like, it's not at all like Borat. But it's Bort, and he's like, my wife. That's what he say.
So how long was your initial contract with Comedy Central when you signed on to do Nick Swardson Pretend Time? Because usually a TV contract is a 6-year contract in network stuff.
Right. Yeah, but this wasn't like that. I mean, it's...
Right. Yes.
No, they would just pick us up like 8 episodes, and that's what I was contracted to do. I could still do other stuff.
How many times were you picked up to do... So how many seasons?
We did 2 seasons.
Okay.
2 seasons,
and
16
you out
episodes.
That, like 16 episodes? That's... I'm only because I know nothing about what you do. Like, doing it... Like, I would think I would like to do a show like this, but then you're like a cautionary tale of you don't because it sucks.
It didn't suck, and I didn't hate it. It just was like... It's so creatively, it just was exhausting. It was like, because we had to do, like when you watch Chappelle's show, he would do a sketch that would be like 8 minutes long. He would do like a long sketch. Our mandate was shorter sketches and more sketches. So we would have to do like 12 sketches in an episode that would be 2 minutes long. So that's 12 different characters, that's 12 different locations, that's 12 different, you know, I mean, it was just like the production value was just so fucking intense.
Did it ever occur to you to, and I'm being serious, sounds like I'm being a dick, and I'm not, why not just, like, hire some of your friends to
do sketches? Oh, fuck you, man. I'm just kidding. What?
Why not outsource that shit?
Because they didn't want me to outsource it.
Get
they were
some
like
Indian people.
They were...
robot.
Bort.
Why it made me laugh so hard.
No, they
I mean,
wouldn't.
Everybody laughed.
We couldn't outsource it. It was like Nick Swardson's Pretend Time, so they're like, you have to be. I tried to do it. I gave Finesse Mitchell like a couple sketches.
What?
Yes.
He was here. He drank all the vodka.
I know. And then I drank the rest of it.
I'm going to order a glass of ice cold vodka. Or as Finesse. He was here and he said, man, that's good vodka. I said, you do realize there's a D in vodka, right? And he said, not the way I say it. That's vodka.
Vodka?
That's vodka.
Waka flaka vodka?
Like, yeah. So people can go to Amazon and purchase Nick Swardson's Pretend Time through jmoore.com. There's always a hustle, Nicholas.
Right, all right.
Here's an email from somebody, Roger Cavillo. I always tell you guys, if you buy something on Amazon through the J. Moore website, email me and I'll read it on the show. Hey, Jay, here's my Amazon purchase through the banner on your website. Your book, No Wonder My Parents Drank, Tales from a Stand-Up Dad. First of all, respect that. That's tight.
That's very tight.
Tangled, the Blu-ray, REM Document 25th Anniversary CD. All right. And then all of a sudden it gets a little weird.
Yes.
And the Disney Princess Toy Chest. What?
What is that?
Is that to put your books and CDs and DVDs in?
I don't know what you put in that.
Oh, Tangled is like a little kid-girl movie, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Were you in REM? What does that have to do with you?
That's what he bought. If you go to jmoore.com, there's an Amazon banner. You click on it, and it takes you to Amazon.
Oh,
and I get credit for what you buy.
Okay.
So people want to buy season 1 of Nick Swardson Pretend Time,
Jesus.
You go to my website and do it.
Go to fucking jmoore.com and click on Amazon.
Why don't you fucking Jesus fart Christ. In my mouth, and we'll guess who did it.
You are you... You...
What?
Were we just... Should we talk about your NyQuil experience?
Yeah, you're very sweaty today.
I'm very sweaty.
Why are you so sweaty today?
That wasn't the topic that I just brought up.
Oh, I didn't know if you wanted.
Oh, okay.
If you wanted to start from a spot.
Okay. I'm sweating.
Sunday.
I'm gushing sweat today.
You had a big Sunday.
I had a pretty big Sunday. Yeah.
Yeah.
I drank.
We're recording this on a Monday. A
lot of vodka.
And Nick showed up in my house. First of all, Nicholas is the first guest that Teresa, best doorman in Hollywood. I mean, she stonewalled Jerry Seinfeld. And made John Sally wait in the car like, no, I'm sorry, you don't look right. And Nicholas actually texted me from inside my house, which is a little weird. My wife's upstairs sleeping, the baby's running around. Oh, the baby was with me. And I'm like, wow. I'm like, where are you? And he's like, where are you? And the voice is coming from the baby's playroom. I'm like, okay. So Teresa let you in. You passed the smell test.
I think she just was like worried about me. Like literally.
She didn't think went to stay home.
I think she was just like... This
Dios
dude is
mio.
Covered in sweat.
Dios mio. And I like that you did an impression of a Mexican nanny in front of my Mexican nanny. That was class. When I go, she let you in. She didn't let John Sally in. And you go, yeah. She was like, you need to wait in the baby's turf.
Not do that.
I swear to you, did it right there by the island. I have an island in my house.
We'll go back to the
rich.
Tape
an actual
on that.
Island. You were like, you need to sit in the car. You can't come in.
I can't do an impression that good.
Well, I didn't say you did it as well as me.
Okay.
I'll listen up, girl. So then we were talking about things that we've quit. I told you the acupuncturist tells me and I need to stop drinking coffee, and I laugh at them and I say, if you knew all the things I quit,
right,
you would let me have coffee. Like if I, NyQuil, two bottles of NyQuil a day, and then Nicholas said you had a front row seat for the
NyQuil. I had a front row seat. Well, do people know our history or backstory that we go back probably 15 years?
That I was your lover.
We were lovers.
Lovers. We took a canned ham and rubbed the grease on our face.
Yes.
It's like something Harlan Williams would say. I just did a different accent. You and I worked together a lot doing stand-up comedy throughout the Southwest, it seems like, exclusively.
I opened for you a lot, and my favorite was one time Jay calls me up. I just moved to L.A. from New York. I don't know L.A. I didn't know L.A. at all at this point, so I didn't know traffic or anything. So I'm living in Venice. Jay lived in the hills, in Hollywood Hills, which was essentially an hour away. Mm-hmm. So, from where I was, essentially.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So Jay calls me up, he's like, hey, what's up? I got, Laker tickets, you wanna go? I'm like, alright. Just be at my house at 5. So like an idiot, I left my house
at... Why do I sound like fucking Duval in The Great Santini?
That was my impression of Bort.
Alright, why do I sound like Bort?
I don't know.
Come on, sports fans!
I like
what
doing,
are you gonna cry? Give me a little squirt!
I like doing impressions of people and making them really weird, and then I just wait for the person to call me out on it.
they just, but I like this impression of me, actually. What? So please don't stop.
So, you're like, you'll be my house at 5. So I leave my house at 4. I'm in traffic at 4:30. I'm like 5 minutes. Like, I go a mile. Traffic's so bad. I'm not even close to getting to Jay's house. I'm like, hey, bud, I'm not gonna make it. I left my house at 4. Jay goes, you fucking idiot! Who does that? Fuck. Asshole. And then hung up the phone. And then didn't talk to me for like a month. And then I bought you and your fucking wife massages to make up for...
Sorry, here's a massage.
Fucking
nice
ass.
Time. Why does that make me an asshole? Because you couldn't...
Because I was a fucking kid who didn't know what he was doing. I wasn't like fucking...
Do you think I owe you an apology for that?
Yeah. I mean, it was 15 years ago, but...
I'll apologize for being so gruff with you. Are you saying I should have on the phone been like, hey man, I understand you're new to town? Because in my mind, I got two. I'm holding Laker tickets. I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna invite my buddy Nicholas. We're gonna sit on the floor. I'll blow his fucking mind. Hey, I can't make it. I'm like, what do you mean you can't make it?
No, I was en route.
Maybe you owe me an apology because you stood me up for a Laker game because you managed your time properly.
I did apologize on the phone. I fucking said I was sorry. I was really sorry.
And then what did I say?
No, dude.
You fucking idiot. Fucking. You want to fucking eat me out?
The bully where shit doesn't come out, right? You got an eye problem? What, you want to eat me out? You want to eat my box?
You want to fucking eat me out?
Why don't you come eat my box? Come eat my fucking box. I dare you to eat my box until I come all over your fucking face.
I'll fucking suck your dad's dick.
It's like, Wait, what?
How was that a threat?
I apologize for being aggressive and mean to you on the phone, but it seems to be a common theme on the podcast, the discovery of what a dick I once was.
I never said you were a dick. It just was like...
Well, that's a dick. I mean, then why am I apologizing?
It was just harsh. You just be like, hey, guys.
Harsh cinnamon for dick, no? Cinnamon.
Hard dick.
Cinnamon.
Hard dick.
Delicious.
That's what you're saying?
Cinnamon dick.
So we did stand-up together, and then you started drinking NyQuil.
How did... I did. But how did we meet? And then we'll go back to NyQuil. I don't remember us meeting.
We met in New York. Jesus. Did your ass just say Bort? Is your ass trying to do a Bort impression?
What do you mean trying?
What do you mean trying?
My ass is closing with that impression. My ass is like, let me just tell you guys one more thing, and then I'll let you guys off into the night here. Bort? I know, we go to Irvine Improv October 4th, and we've had a great time tonight, but my asshole wants to say one thing. Bort? Good night, everybody. Thanks for coming. And
good night.
Like,
I would assume we met through Barry.
Hey, man. Barry said the nicest things about you on this podcast. And inspiring nice things. Do you want to hear what he said before or do you want to just go to NyQuil? And...
No, I can. Yeah, what did he say? Well, first of all, I'm a fucking nice guy.
You are a nice guy. I don't think Teresa thinks you're particularly nice because you mocked her heritage in her face. Like,
why don't you sit in the baby stroller? Listen, so black man, you can't come in here. Mira, hold my baby.
You started doing Pablo Francisco's impression of a Mexican lady.
Hold my baby. Look at me like you.
That's another good story.
Which one?
We were at the Irvine Improv, and I was so fucking. There was no MC. I had to cold open the show. And I was so pissed, and I was being a fucking baby, I'll admit it. I was like, oh, fuck, there's an opener, am I going to go cool? So Pablo Francisco, who's a good friend of mine and Jay's, was at the show just to watch as a friend. So Jay goes, hey, Pablo, you want to open up the show? And Pablo's like, yeah, I'd love it. So Pablo went on first. And before he went on stage, I grabbed him, and I'm like, Pablo, fucking don't do your A material, dude. Just fuck around, please. Because Pablo's one of the most powerful comics, just in terms of crowd. Like, he just kills. I mean, he's amazing. He's one of my favorites. So I was like, don't do your fucking A shit, dude. And he's like, I won't. He did all of his fucking A shit just ripped the crowd a new asshole. They were like,
long, too, right?
Yeah, he did like 20 minutes.
You kept coming up to me like, what the fuck is he doing?
And I was like, you know what he's doing, Nick? He's opening the show cold.
I know.
So I guess I was a dick, too.
And then
I taught you a real lesson.
Yeah, it was pretty funny though. So I had to go out. I had to go out with like literally where I was normally like really casual and low energy. I had to go out with like sparklers and fucking like I think I did like a fucking triple Lutz onto the stage, like trying to keep the crowd's attention. I was like, fuck.
You're like, hey, have a round of applause for all the men and women serving overseas.
Just keep.
We were talking about all the haters. Me and Barry were talking about all like the haters on Twitter and people just talk shit. And Barry goes, let me tell you something. You want to know why Whitney has a sitcom? Because she fucking wrote it, and she sold it, and she breaks her ass. Here's another story. And then he wiped his fucking teeth. Barry Katz, the only guy I've ever seen wipe his teeth mid-conversation. Like when there's a little bit of rain, and your windshield, you would wipe for your car that one time. Like, Barry will go, let me tell you something, man. And just wipe his fucking teeth.
So he wipes it with, like, a beach towel. Just, there's so much teeth there.
A ball gets played off the wall by Johnny Damon. Johnny Damon plays a ball off Barry's teeth, throws it in. So Barry goes, let me tell you a little story. Nick Swardson, friend of ours, right? Nick Swardson was fired by his management company after his special aired. I think it was Dave Becky or somebody. I don't know who it was.
Dave Becky.
His special airs, they drop him. Doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Nick calls me in New York at my office. It's a Sunday. You know, Barry gets held up on weird parts of the story that don't matter.
Right.
It's a Sunday. You know, like you spend all day Saturday and like 4 minutes later. So it's a Sunday. It's a Sun. I'm like, I got it.
You have to explain what Sunday is.
Sunday. Some people say it's the first day of the week, and then other people say it's the last day of the week, depending on what calendar you go. So he goes, Nick Swardson goes, can I come to your office and use your copier machine, man? And he comes in. He's got a backpack. And the kid looks like he's been through some trauma, man. And he takes out one of those spiral notebooks. You know those old spiral notebooks from high school? Those binder, those spiral notebooks. It'll say three or, you know, they'll have partitions for check. I'm like, yeah, notebook, I got it. He goes, and he wrote Malibu's Most Wanted for Jamie Kennedy. He goes, I want to get this to my friend Jamie. Handwritten an entire script and spent Sunday copying it and sending it to people. That's why Nick Swardson's fucking successful. Because on a Sunday with a spiral notebook, he came in. So Barry was like super telling all the morons and warriors and more, I don't know what else their names are. Huh? The Maureens and the Mormons and the ultimate warriors. Like, if you want it, go fucking do it. Like Nick Swardson did it. So we met through Barry, and then you saw the NyQuil up close.
Yeah, we started doing stand-up, and then you were like, we were driving to Phoenix, and you're like, I'm going to pull over real quick. And you go and fucking buy two bottles of NyQuil, and then you proceeded to drink it while you're driving, and halfway through the road trip, you looked over, and it looked like you had literally eaten out a fucking Avatar's asshole. Your fucking mouth was so blue, it looked like 50 fucking Smurf dicks had fucking exploded.
Like, I didn't drink it well. Like, I spilled it all over my bed.
Yeah. I was just sitting there in the shotgun seat, just like, am I going to fucking, what is happening right now? What's going to happen to me? Is this dude just going to float off into fucking...
Nick's like, you drink NyQuil, you have a fucking problem. Where can we buy booze and coke?
Yeah.
A real fucking party. And heroin. And let's do fucking acid all day.
Jesus. That's your thing. Acid all day.
No, God.
I know your type, Swartz. And you come in from Minnesota, you and Louis Anderson. And
I don't fucking do drugs. That's a bit misconception.
You and Louis Anderson all day with, yeah, I'm tripping balls off. How about you, Nick?
I don't do drugs. Everybody thinks that I'm a big drug addict. I always joke about cocaine.
I know you're a drug addict.
I always joke about cocaine and shit. I don't smoke pot. Everybody thinks that, like...
I know for a fact that you're not a drug addict.
Yeah.
But you jumped on that pretty hard, like...
Well, I just want people to know because I don't like that out there. Like, people...
I don't
like that reputation.
Come on. You want to leg game? Come on. Nick, what are you doing? Fucking down. You want to leg game? Fucking forget it.
Yeah, I don't even like the Lakers. I'm not a Laker fan.
I don't like them either. I think they could eat a bag of dicks. I like the Knicks and you like the Timberwolves. We're both fucking idiots.
We're both fucked. The best was I met a bowling alley like a year or two ago. Dwight Howard's there, like two lanes down from me in L.A. And I'm like, oh, fuck, it's Dwight Howard. He looks over, he sees me, he recognizes me. He's like, yo, what's up, man? So I walk over and he's like, yeah, actor, comedian, right? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, you're funny. I was like, thanks, man. I was like, dude, I love the magic. I'm friends with J.J. Redick and shit. And he was like, oh, cool. And then I was like a little drunk. And so I just decided to be a fucking idiot. And I just go, what's up with Kobe Bryant? And Dwight Howard goes, what? And I go, that guy's like a fucking asshole, right? And it was just like so awkward. And he just goes, no, I mean, I know him. And I was like, right. Okay, later. I just, like, totally threw this stupid wrench into the fucking conversation I was having. So nice with Dwight Howard.
But you seem to do it a lot in life because your special, your DVD and CD that I have that I play in my truck, my wife and I were driving back from San Francisco listening to...
Party or Seriously Who Farted?
Seriously Who Farted.
Yeah.
No, it was Party. Excuse me. You're right. Because it's you. It's a big party on the cover.
Yeah, it's me holding a 40 with a fucking tattoo on my chest.
And you go, guy's at a urinal, and you're at the urinal next to him, and you just look at the guy, and you didn't know what to say, so you went, party.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm constantly putting
party. What's up with fucking Kobe? You should have said party to Dwight Howard, and the guy at the urinal, you should have said, what's up with fucking Kobe Bryant? And the guy at the urinal would have went, right? Party.
I mean, right? Gargle.
What was the bit about your taking your cat to the vet that I love so much? Why don't you walk us through that bit, Nicholas?
It's one of my favorite jokes. I go, oh, my cat, I have a cat, he's sick right now, he has diarrhea. And I brought him to the vet, and the vet goes, what have you been feeding him? And I go, diarrhea. And the best was, when I first started coming up as a comedian, Variety, which is like the big Hollywood magazine here, they did a whole thing about 10 young comics to watch. So they picked me as one of the 10 comics. And a lot of my jokes are really long, and that joke's really short. So they put that as, like, the example of why I'm, like, one of the top young comics to watch. They put my cat diarrhea joke.
Don't sleep on this guy.
Yeah. They put my stupid cat diarrhea.
Dandy, Nicholas Schwartz, and he does it all. Diarrhea jokes with the cat.
Diarrhea, baby, dickie me. So I'm on the plane, and I have the magazine with me, and my buddy fucking Howard from Jersey, like, grabs the stewardess. He's like, hey, my buddy's fucking blowing up. He's in this magazine. And she looks at it. She goes, can I borrow this? And I go, yeah. She fucking goes to the front of the plane, gets on the intercom thing. And she goes, hey, everybody, we have a stand-up comedian on the flight today. And they're like, in row 35C or whatever. And everyone's turning around. I'm just like, oh, my God, this is not happening. She goes, he's a comedian, and here's one of his jokes. She reads the fucking joke out of the magazine and gets it totally wrong. She just goes, he has a cat, it's got diarrhea, it eats diarrhea. And the whole fucking plane is staring at me like I'm the biggest idiot piece of shit. And it was like a flight to like New York from LA. It was like a 6-hour flight. I just had to sit there. Well, everybody who went to the bathroom just stared at me like I was fucking Bin Laden's dick.
And then she used it to wipe up her own diarrhea. She used
what?
Then she used the article to wipe up her own diarrhea.
Yeah, and then slapped me in the face with it.
Sprayed it.
Make it stink.
fucking chloroform the pilot with a variety with your wet with her wet diarrhea on it. I probably took that too far.
It's fine. It deserved it.
Hey, everybody. Nick Swardson. This cat has diarrhea.
Here he is.
Stand up! But you can't stand up all the way because of the luggage rack, so you're hunched over like a prawn.
So I knock myself out. I stand up and fucking hit my head, and then they have to, like, revive me with shitting in my mouth.
You're so excited that you jump out of your seat, and the oxygen mask falls down right as you're coming around and hits you in the eye, and you go, oh!
Ow.
Good one, Maddie. Oh, my Christ. God, you make me laugh, Nicholas. We did Irvine a lot, Brett. We did a lot of Orange County. And then we did a lot of Orange County. Phoenix. That's the drive where I hit that fucking bird with my windshield.
You had a Mercedes?
S5. Shit was tight. Rolling. I ride spinners. Shit was tight.
And when you hit a bird, you were going 120 miles an hour.
On cruise control.
And it was, I almost fucking threw up. It was the grossest. It was so fucking gross. It hits the windshield like a fucking apple. Just explodes blood and guts all over the fucking windshield.
And I remember
I start gagging, and you're like, holy fuck!
Well, yeah.
Like, I thought it was a fucking pterodactyl or something. It was so fucking big. And then you turn on the wipers, and the fucking guts are just going all over the windshield. I could barely jerk off.
I did that as a bit that whole weekend. I did it for a bit for... I'll dip into that once in a while.
You did it for a while, yeah.
It's a good bit for like a corporate because I could do it completely clean. But it is like raises the question of like, do you know how hard it is to hit a bird? That's what fascinated me about the whole thing after the fact. Right when it happened, I'm like, this is a brand new Mercedes. This is not cool that it's covered in blood. People are going to think of fucking Ray Carruth making a run for it. I'm going to say, hey, yo, could have said OJ. Went somewhere else with that face scoreboard. And Nick goes, oh, my God, that poor bird. You just kept saying it over and over. And I'm like, I have a fucking ruined Mercedes. Who cares? I'm like, look, there's another bird. I'm pointing out the window. And you know what? I was a dick. Because I remember I had the sunroof open, not all the way open, just where it's glass. And I'm like, look, there's another bird right there, dude. You know what else you don't see right here? Another Mercedes. You see? Look around.
That's right. Like, I remember that.
And you're like,
I was really upset.
Poor bird. And I'm like, my fucking car, dude. It's covered in guts.
It was literally looked so gross. Looked like Andre the Giant like threw up spaghetti marinara. Fucking. It was so awful. It was so awful.
Into Big John's red hair. Sorry, you're gonna get it out. It looked like Andre the Giant threw up spaghetti marinara and Big John's thud's long blonde hair, then shaved the hair in the vomit and then threw it on the windshield. Or the way you said it was fine too.
Or
Bort.
Bort.
And did I drink a lot of NyQuil on that trip?
That was a big NyQuil trip for you.
Did my personality change when I drank the NyQuil?
Not really, no. It was weird. It made you, like, energetic, which was really bizarre. Like, you weren't, like, catatonic or anything. You were, like, it would, like, pep you up. It was fucking weird.
Yeah, I was an addict. It's like when I smoked grass, I used to get super hyper too. And I was super like goal oriented. Like those commercials about pot when the guy's on the couch like, yeah, I'll do it tomorrow, man. I'm like, I don't know what the fuck that guy's deal is. If I smoke grass, I'm going to manicure my lawn with fucking tweezers.
I just remembered another fucking story. I forgot about this one. It makes me laugh. I think you'll think this is funny. I think it's funny. I remember I was so fucking broke. I was living in a studio apartment, and I had no money. So I, you know, opened for you, and
say that like it's community service.
No. You were great. You
I had to
fucking.
Open for you. You know, the judge was like, "Do you want to pick up trays on the highway or open for Jay Moore? You had to do 20 minutes. Sometimes you might have to go cold. You know." That was Colin Dangerfield.
That's amazing.
Sometimes you have to go cold. You know.
No, one time, this is so good. you called me up. You're like, I'm doing a college. You want to go with me? I'm like, yeah. Okay. You're just like, just do 20 minutes. I'm like, okay, how much?
Why do I sound like a lesbian?
I don't know. I'm having fun with your impression.
Hey.
So you go, I go, how much? And you go, $100. I go, what? $100? And then you go, dude, what the fuck? And I go, can I have a little more? I'm like sleeping in a studio apartment. Like, you guys, I'm doing 20 minutes. And you go, fine, I'll give you 200. And I'm like, thank you. And then you go, by the way, I'm not fucking getting that much for this college anyway. And I go, what are you getting? And you go, I'm only getting 20 grand. And I was like, fuck. I go, I want 1,000. You're like, no, fuck, I shouldn't have said that. I was like,
what college
fuck.
Was it?
It was the one where they fucking spazzed out on you for being, they said your Schindler's List joke was racist.
What?
Remember your Calvin Klein ads?
It was Cal Berkeley, and we drove up together.
We drove up.
So Cal Berkeley, I do remember that. And I remember saying to you, before this phone call, it was $0.
yeah, that's right.
Like, what's your problem? I'm going to drive you there, put you up, we'll hang out, and I'll hand you $200 just for taking a fucking car ride with me, man. What's your problem?
Yeah, that's right.
Before this call, it was zero. I don't get it, Nick. What's your deal? Fuck! You know what? Fuck the Lakers.
No, remember? And then you go, we did the gig, and you did that joke. You go, Calvin Klein ads.
I said, does anybody remember when models used to be pretty? Holy smokes. Have you seen the Calvin Klein ad? It's like Schindler's List with Chinese people.
Yeah. And so you do your set, and the student council took us out afterwards. And it was so uncomfortable, and they were so...
We were high. We laughed the whole time.
We were the only people laughing.
We laughed like we were on, like, mushrooms. Like, we were on the edge of... For the listener, there's, like, 20 people involved, because they all just kind of want to be next to show business.
Yeah, there's, like, 20 kids that took us out to an Olive Garden after the gig.
And they're putting on, like, Sweeney Todd at, like, UCal, like, da-da-da, at least my arm's complete. Like, these are the people in, quote, show business, so they're going to hang out with us as part of the deal. Like, then you go out with these people, have a nice time. Well, guess what? It wasn't a nice time, because 16 out of the 20 were Asian, and for some reason thought I was anti-Asian, because
they fucking, like, totally unloaded on you. This girl was so fucking butthurt.
She said, why did you have to say that? And I said, I'm really confused. And I was diplomatic at first.
Yeah.
And she goes, it's like Calvin Klein. It's like Schindler's List with Chinese people. That seems so anti-Chinese. I go, no, it's anti-model, because the models are so skinny. And then you remember this? She goes, but why do they have to be Chinese? I go, because they're fucking Chinese. It's a fucking China. There's like 3 Chinese people in the Calvin Klein ad. And then there's like this dead silence. And you go, can I get another lava flow?
yeah, that's right.
You were on the edge of the table, and you knew if you said anything or looked in either direction, you would scream laughing.
I was trying not to laugh the whole time. And then I had some fruity cocktail, and I remember halfway in the middle of them yelling at you, I just stood up and I just went, everybody, welcome to the island. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do remember
And then we
that.
Just started laughing. Like Fantasy Island, I was like, welcome to the island.
It was so surprising to me. Like, Cal is supposed to be, like, the liberal hub of free speech and, like, everything. Like, hey, man, you know.
No, I find colleges to be.
They were the biggest douches.
I love doing colleges, but I find them to be way more PC.
Yeah.
I mean, they're fun, and I love it, but, like, I've had problems with jokes where people are like, oh.
And she also said in that story, when you said, and the 2 black guys came up to your car, why did they have to... She like, broke down my act like math, like Asians do. There's a fucking Asian joke, you dumb cunt from Cal. That's probably now a fucking scientist.
Again, huh? Look what I discovered.
There, now that's racist. That's the difference between what I...
No, it's not. Difference. You're calling her a scientist. It's a compliment.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Right now, doing fucking pedicures.
Oh, look what I discover.
Is that racist? I'm trying to be racist.
It's getting more racist. Yeah.
Okay. working on the railroad, spitting in the fucking street, killing her child if it's not a boy.
Oh, look what I discover.
Thinking Andy Rooney was great in Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Oh, he good Chinaman.
Andy Rooney, wasn't it Mickey Rooney?
No, not the one I have.
Andy Rooney from 60 Minutes.
I got a bootleg.
Isn't it weird when people want what they can't have?
So real quick, the lady goes, but why did they, you say, and then you say the two black guys come up to your car. It was a story, like it was something that actually happened to me. And she goes, but why did you say two black guys? And I said, do you remember this? I go, because it was two black guys. And she said, and now everyone at the table, at this long ass table, is just
everyone's
staring
watching
at us. Because she's the leader of their crew.
Yeah, she was the head of their student council.
Like, she's a senior, and she's like, me Chinese. So they're all like, we want to be tiny too. So she goes, why did they have to be black? And I go, because they were black. They were actually black men.
Right.
And she said, well, if they were white guys, you wouldn't say that white guys came to your car. And then all of a sudden, like, sometimes you don't know if you're smart on something or not until you're forced with it at that moment. And
right.
I realized at that moment, I actually was somewhat intelligent when it came to comedy and sociology, because I had to explain to this fucking, me Chinese straight A, a cow, student. And I said, I am a white guy surrounded by white people from birth, from my DNA, all the way up until this afternoon. White, 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 white. So a black person is an interloper in my world, such as, or there, you know, if a group of black people are sitting on their front porch in their black neighborhood where they see black people and go to a black school and a black church, if two white guys went up the street, if me and Nicholas went up the street, they for the next year would go, you remember that day those fucking two white guys came rolling up? They wouldn't go, those two guys. Like, what the fuck are you talking about? And she goes, mingo, mingo, mingo. And then Nick stands up
she
and goes,
she said Kinko's three times?
She's, yeah. And she was like, that's what we're all going to be working after this show.
I mean, you explained yourself really well. And then the best part was then they all asked for your autograph afterwards, even her. They wanted a picture and an autograph. I was like, what the fuck?
It was weird. And you're sitting there
you just
going,
yelled at him for an hour. And now
I'm
you're like,
free.
Suicide King, say cheese.
How many free tropical drinks did you have? Four?
Around. Around?
Bort. Probably four. I have Bort.
And then you had, like, chicken fettuccine.
I don't remember
you really
what
got, like, a $260 payday.
Yeah, it was a juicy payday.
The passive income and a free ride up and back with gas. That's a three.
The ride was a good, that was a perk.
You know, just the time spent together. You and I always laugh like fools when we're together.
Yeah, we always laugh like fucking idiots.
Why?
Because we're really dumb. No, I'm just kidding.
No, you're not.
I don't know.
But some people like that are really good, that I'm really good friends with, we don't, there's like a weird button you and I pushing each other where we're just like absolute morons together. It's joyful. And I'm happy that you're here.
I think I'm glad to be here. I think we're just silly.
You're
like, we're both silly. You know what I mean? Like,
why
some
you
people,
silly?
Some people are funny in a different way, but it's different when you're like fucking just goofy. You know what I mean?
I
like,
do.
Like, we're like always kind of like on helium or something.
You and I, I remember this in Phoenix. They go, hey, there's a musician in town staying at your, I think we were at the Mission Palms in Tempe.
Yeah.
And they go, this musician is, Leona Ness is staying in your hotel. Or, no, they were at the bar. I was drinking. No, I was drinking NyQuil at the bar.
Yeah.
But I wasn't drinking. In my mind, I had not broken my sobriety because I was drinking NyQuil, which is not booze. So I'm literally, you are drinking with Leona Ness and her band. Do you remember this?
Yeah, and they were great,
and they
by
were
the
trying
way.
To close, and the bartender was like, you know what, you guys are cool, I'll just stay open. And we just tipped the shit out of the bartender, like, just hang out and let us, just give us a bottle.
Right.
And I'm sitting there holding, like, NyQuil in a plastic bag, like, you guys are fucking alcoholics, man. Gee,
yeah, literally, it was in, like, a paper bag, like a fucking weirdo.
Yeah. And then Leona Ness was the girl.
Yeah, then we drove around and listened to her CD in the desert.
Yeah, she gave us the CD, and you and I were going to spring training baseball. I think it was the Giants and the Pirates. We were like, fucking Barry Bonds, batting practice. And we got there late because we were just fucking hungover. And then on the way there, I cleaned all the dead bird off my car. All the Andre the Giant vomit off my car. And then we put her CD in, and like a billion times in your life, if you live in L.A., somebody goes, hey, listen to my CD. Or like the parking lot of Ralph's, yo, player.
Yeah.
My new demo, I'd appreciate it. If you give my demo a holla, son, Facebook that shit, man. Tag me up. And you're like, ugh, I got to buy this, otherwise he'll beat me up.
Yeah, but her CD was incredible. She's still really brilliant.
Where did she go? But long story short, and I apologize to everybody, Nick and I are driving to Phoenix. Driving to this game to watch Barry Bonds hit batting practice, roided out of his fucking head, and we put Leona Ness. She's Diana Ross's goddaughter, right?
Yeah. She's just this frail, sweet, cute little white girl.
We put the CD in, and, like, it made us, like, sad, and we're driving through, like, the desert. It's like, why can't you be with me? This, like, love song. And Nick and I were, like, looking at each other going, oh, my God. Like, the one in a million shot that the person that handed you their CD. Yeah. Look at that, man.
We were both like, this is going to take us so long to come.
Speak for yourself, mister.
For some reason, a really quick story about that same hotel. I just remember this when I did the Tempe Improv with Jamie Kennedy. And it was me and Jamie in this car, and this girl he met after the show. And we were sitting in front of the hotel that you were staying at. This is the same hotel. And we're sitting there. I'm in the back seat. This girl's driving. Jamie's in the shotgun seat. And he goes, you want to go up to my room, to the girl? And she goes, yeah. And he goes, let me get this straight, though. If we go up there, I'm not going up there to rent a fucking movie. And she goes, what do you mean? And he goes, if we go up there, like, we're going to, you know, I don't want to just fucking sit. I want to fuck around. And she goes, yeah, I mean, I guess. I don't know. And he goes, fuck this. And he just gets out of the fucking car. He's like, I'm too old for it. He said something like that. I was sitting in the back seat, and he forgot I was still back there. So I was just sitting there, like, so uncomfortable. And I was like, do you want to rent a movie? She was like, no, fuck both of you guys. We're like, yeah, that's what we want. And then she was like, no, you guys are fucking idiots.
And that girl's name was Amy Schumer.
And that girl's name was Marsha Warfield from TV's Night Court.
I don't know, Bull. You better take it up with the judge. Close?
That was close.
Who? So you're from Minnesota, right?
Yep, born and raised. Got a tattoo.
That's the 612
area code? 612 area code, man.
Why are you such a Duke basketball fan from Minnesota? Why don't you follow your Golden Gophers all the way to the fucking NIT?
I don't know.
That's the alarm for bad jokes.
Boop. I've been a Duke fan my whole life, so I was 8 years old. Before any championships, way before anything.
What do you mean before? They had championships your whole life. So
no, they didn't.
What was it about Duke that made you enjoy Duke?
Oh my God.
Is that your car alarm?
I don't think so.
You know, it is probably some Chinese lady from Cal, like, I'll choose the bacon to dip off.
I skateboarded.
Somebody emailed me on my website, and he goes, I notice you guys really make fun of blacks way too much, and it's really offensive. I'm a black guy, and I can put up with a lot. And I emailed the guy back, and as nicely as I could, I was like, are you out of your fucking mind? Do you hear what we say about each other, like, all the time, how fucking stupid we are? We're making fun of Tracy Morgan. Isn't making fun of a black guy. It's making fun of, like, a Martian. Do you know what I mean? Like, just because I go, I'm going to get you pregnant, that doesn't mean I'm fucking mocking black people. And the guy wrote back, goes, yeah, you're right. I'm probably overly sensitive.
Everyone's overly fucking sensitive. It's like, Jesus Christ, who cares?
So why did you like Duke so much?
What? I don't know. There was just sort of like their camaraderie. I swear to God, there was
why
just
I
like
the Nazi party in '39. I just
Jesus.
No.
I also like because they shot a lot of threes, and I like I was like a shooting guard, and they drained so many threes, and I just thought it was exciting.
I
also love the color blue.
You played shooting guard?
Yeah, drain, motherfuckers.
I thought you played left out.
Hey.
Hey, Nick, what are you doing? You want to shoot hoops?
Who's that?
It's you doing me.
Oh, yeah. Hey, what's up?
Oh, yeah. Like, that was like 2 days ago.
Hey. Hey, I know you're new to town.
Oh, fuck you.
You want to go to... You want to go to Laker game with me? You want to go to Laker game with me?
Where's my massage?
What do you mean you can't make it? The fuck? Fucking dickhead.
Here's my impression of Nick Swardson. Ready?
I gotta go up cold. What if they don't like me?
What if they yell at me?
Pablo, you go first. I'm not going up cold.
And then Pablo's like, in a world,
I puppy.
And Nick's like, oh my God, what have I done?
Oh, my kid. And my wife.
Bort. I'm developing. I want to say my new TV show I'm developing. So I want you to be, do something on it.
I would love to.
It's called Bro Assassin, and I play a ninja that lives at a frat house.
I love that. Is gay robot making an appearance?
Maybe.
I would like to meet. Where is the gay robot? In storage at Comedy Central? Like, for real, where's the physical thing, the suit?
Probably at Rage right now. In the bathroom.
I've never seen so much coke on a toilet seat.
Rage is a gay bar in West Hollywood.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought you meant...
I was just telling the viewership. So, yeah, if you want to play, be an assassin...
I would love it.
My friend Danny McBride is producing the show. The guys who did Eastbound and Down are producing it.
Those are heavy hitters, man.
Yes.
You've had a lot of people back you. I mean, Mama's Boy, was that you?
Grandma's Boy, yeah.
Grandma's Boy, sorry.
Yes.
And then Bucky Larson, was that a Happy Madison production?
Yeah, that was...
Now, how did that not... It seems like it didn't even get off the ground, really.
It didn't. Well, you just got...
Your picture of you, the ad was a picture of you, and you look like Randy Quaid from Kingpin.
I know, I look like a fucking
Dutch
goof.
Boy haircut.
I think it was just, it's tough to market rated R comedies, because it's like...
Well, Adam...
And it was a character that nobody knew, it didn't pre-exist. It was just a character that Adam had thought up, and then talked to me about it, and then we wrote the script.
I got an idea for a show where you were this guy. I would do it myself, but it's even stupid for me.
But no, we love Bucky, man. Bucky's awesome. I just thought it was so underrated. I mean, critics, we got crucified, man. I mean, you literally thought I released a sex tape with Bin Laden, like the way they reacted to it. It was like... People were, like, sending me, like, death threats. I was like, Jesus.
Bin Laden now or Bin Laden, like, a year ago?
Bin Laden done that.
Bin Laden done that.
But I love Bucky Larson, so...
Get her, Laden.
I think it's good.
If you could make a sex date with anybody, for real, who would you make one with? For the value for your career. Like, if one was going to get out. And you in full, like, full hard dick, like... Shooting loads, the whole, like, everybody sees everything. Male, female, fucking animal, anything you want just to make your career go up. Who would you, if you could hand pick?
I would say Blake Lively or Brad Pitt.
Why not Brad Lively?
Why not Blake Pitt?
Why not Jay Cutler? Oh, wait, no, Ryan Reynolds. I got him mixed up. Jay Cutler's married to... one of those chicks.
Oh my God, I know her.
Christy Cavallari.
Cavallari, yeah.
You guys are good friends, I could tell. Good old what's her name?
Well, that's
how do you know Christy Cavallari?
I've known Kristen for a long time.
Because she went to Duke. She played center.
No, she
Bobby
we did a
Hurley to Cavallari. Yes, and it counts.
We did a celebrity charity basketball game, and she was the coach.
Well,
I swear to God, in Phoenix.
What was the charity?
Boys and Girls Club.
Oh, that's awesome. See, that's a real one that I like.
Yeah.
I hate when people, like, go on celebrity poker, and it's like, spay and neuter your pets.
Right.
And you're playing across with somebody for, like, it was David Cross and I think, like, Alyssa Milano were in the finals of this poker charity. Really? I know it was David Cross, but I think I got the girl wrong. And she was playing for dogs and cats. Like an animal shelter, and David Cross was literally playing for, like, babies with AIDS. And in the middle of, like, the final hand for all the marbles, he goes, boy, these kids with AIDS are going to be real happy if you win and save all those animals.
That's hilarious.
But so Boys and Girls Club, we can all get behind.
Yeah, it was dope, man. I like doing those things because we had to play, like, on the actual courts. We went to Phoenix, and we played on the actual Suns court. So
did you
meet
the gorilla?
I did. I fucking ate him out.
I love that. That's the best.
Oh, I felt so bad. This one kid came up. They do these halftime shows where those guys flip on the trampolines.
That's how we do it. Flip on
so it's
the
like
trampoline.
these guys doing like these flips off the trampoline and dunks and everything. And this kid comes up to me and he goes, "Hey man, I'm a huge fan." And I was like, "Cool, dude." And he goes, "I'm gonna do this next dunk. It's real fresh." And I'm like, "Okay." He fucking over-rotated and fucking went face first into the backboard and fucking knocked himself out and fell down onto the floor. You should and everyone said it.
That was fucking fresh, dude. And that was the best Don Gold day.
And then they finally, we woke him up, and and I walked over. I was like, what's going on, man? He goes, that's for sure the most embarrassing thing that'll ever happen to me for the rest of my life. And I go, I thought it was pretty fucking sweet. I'm just glad you're all right.
And then you teabagged his face.
And then we fucking slow fucking kissed. And now we're getting gay fucking married in Fallujah.
You're like, if you thought that was embarrassing, and then you just then you handed him an article about you in Variety.
You think that was embarrassing, and then I take a picture of me blowing him while he was knocked out. I go, nah, it's going to get more embarrassing. Show him a picture.
The Phoenix Suns gorilla, best mascot ever. Better than that stupid Timberwolf you got running around up there at the
Target. Fuck you, man. That's Crunch or Timberwolf.
Crunch?
I love Crunch. Yeah.
I mean, I like him, but I don't love him.
He's a fucking badass, dude.
Why?
I don't know. I'm just trying to support the Timberwolves because nobody else does.
Kevin Love does with his 20,000 rebounds a game. That's a bad white boy, man.
K's my homie.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You know, you have this weird thing where you meet sports guys and you guys just stay friends for the rest of your life.
Yeah, I have, the most random, group of friends.
You're like, yeah, me and Christian Laettner are coming over. And I'm like, wait, what? Christian Laettner's coming over? You're like, yeah, we're out to eat now. We're with some Chinese girl from Cal at the Olive Garden.
Dude, I fucking one time, it was this Christmas, and my buddy calls me up. Or no. I went out drinking with a bunch of my friends, and I forgot it was Jennifer Aniston had at her holiday party. And Jen, I know, because we needed to just go with it together. So she texts me, she's like, hey, are you going to come to my holiday party? And I'm already fucking hammered. So I was like, fuck. So I was like, yeah, I'll come. So I call my buddy from Minnesota, my buddy Justin. He's just a fucking mongoloid. And I go, hey, man, are you sober? And he was like, yeah. And I go, I need you to drive me somewhere. And he goes, what are we doing? And I go, we're going to a holiday party. And I didn't tell him it was Jennifer Aniston. And we walk in, we're fucking hammered, and we park the car. And he gets out and he goes, by the way, I'm fucking totally shit-faced. I'm like, fucking assholes, we're both fucking shit-faced. We walk into a party and we just walk right into fucking Barbara Streisand. And he goes, where the fuck are we? And I go, we're at Jennifer Aniston's house. He just says full-scale panic attack and he goes, I can't go in this. Fuck, I guess this is fucking, I can't do this. He's like, why would you?
Barbara Streisand was like, oh, that was at the party.
She was like, eat me out. But the point of that story was just that my buddy being subjected to.
I thought the point of the story was you name dropping.
I don't name drop.
No?
I mean, I do, but.
Was Jennifer Aniston nice to you?
Yeah, she was great.
How come she was so mean to me and so nice to everybody else in the world? When did I turn into Marin? What about me? How come nobody likes. When I worked with her on Picture Perfect, she was very mean. We covered it in this podcast a long time ago. But then, since then, she asked a friend of mine to say hi to me for her, and I thought that was nice.
Yeah, she's fucking amazing. She's fucking up.
She tapped out?
No, she's fucking my friend.
She's
my friend.
When that kid smashed his face off the backboard, he was your friend.
Yeah.
Oh, did I ever tell you my mascot story when I was at, I think it was Jacobs Field, the All-Star game, and I'm playing in that celebrity softball game, and some mascot.
The Rock and Jock?
Yeah, but it was on ESPN. It wasn't MTV. It wasn't like Dan
Cook. Cock and Block?
It was Cock and Block. Where you go out, and everybody's ready to fuck, and then they just run like naked Betty White, and like mascots like, whoa! And then you lose your erection, and you go, wow, this has been a cock and a block. So yes, you're right. It was Cock and Block, Nick.
Nice.
I'm pitching or something. I'm on the field and a mascot jumps on my back. And I'm like, why? That's a little aggressive. It was like Billy the Marlin or some stupid. Look at those dumb names.
Right.
Or the otter or the fucking seal. Lucille. The seal from the Giants. Basically, all these mascots just start jumping on me. And the Royals mascot is a lion with a big ferocious screaming. Ah, big ferocious face there, you know. Yeah, a giant lion, you know. Oh, my God. With a mask. Where the guy's inside there, you know. Anyway, so the guy jumps on my back. I flip the lion, because it was, really aggressive. And I flip the guy over my shoulder, and I put him in a headlock. And through, this monster screaming lion face, you just hear, stop it, you're hurting.
Really?
I swear to God.
That's amazing.
It was just some, local dancer.
You're fucking hurting me. Stop it, you're hurting.
Jesus.
I like the mascot for Providence That weird friar, that bald friar that walks around. Yeah, the Providence friar.
Wasn't that the old Padres one, too?
Yeah, until they fucked up all their shit and walked out in camouflage like a-holes every fifth day.
I like that stadium.
It is a nice stadium. The Padres had the tightest unis with brown and orange and just had the swinging friar on the sleeve. That shit's tight.
That shit is real tight.
Any gigs you got coming up in October?
I'm getting back into stand-up. I had taken some time off, so I'm getting... What?
To collect your thoughts.
To collect my thoughts. I'm figuring out my schedule, but yeah, I should be doing gigs in the fall. Definitely doing some colleges, but I want to develop this TV show, and then I'm developing another movie with
the director
of Grandma's Boy. Yeah.
I would love to be on I'll be the asshole on Brosassin.
Come on, dude, you gotta drink it, man.
Drink. I'll do. You know what? If you put me in Brosassin, my character will talk like your impression of me.
That'd be amazing.
Come on, dude, gotta. What the fuck? That would actually be funny. A guy just walks in and goes,
you never know what he's saying. He's always
everyone on screen knows what he's saying. As a viewer, you have no idea, and there's no subtitles. He just walks into a room and goes, hey, Dave.
Like when R2-D2 would speak, or Chewbacca. And like, I would be like, yeah, we get
it. All right, R2, we get it. You're chafing.
Stop yelling.
Dane does the best fucking Chewbacca. He'll whip that shit out.
Oh. Everybody does it. Who was the first guy to do that? Wasn't that Harlan? Back in the day? That's some of the first person I remember.
Probably Michael Winslow. The guy from Police Academy?
Yeah.
If I had to bet, I would say he probably did it first.
The dude from Police Academy who did the sound effects? Bort. And me.
Bubba Smith.
One time me and Fitzsimmons were doing Zanies in Chicago.
The three of you at the same time?
I was featuring and Greg was headlining. There was a local MC.
Uh-huh.
In the middle of the week, they go, hey, Michael Winslow is scheduled to do a date in the middle of the week. He's headlining one of the nights. And Greg's like, what the fuck? So they're like, well,
by the way,
sorry.
That's exactly what Greg says most of the time.
So Michael Winslow headlined, and then he was just like super weird. And then so me and Greg just decided to just do sound effects, our whole act in front of him. So we just did. Even in, it didn't even make sense. I'd be like, yeah, I went to the store today. Like chainsaws and like cats and shit.
That's one of the best cat sounds I've ever heard in my life. I'm not kidding. Please do work it somehow.
But yeah, so we just did that the whole time. And then his manager, I think, hated us.
Hold on a second. How would you work the cat sound? I'm sorry. All right, let me get my act together. People are going to go, wow, you guys are fucking high as fuck when you did that podcast. Apparently, if you read the internet after like a show, everyone thinks we're always high. Any show you do where you check like Twitter and people like going, riding your nuts, telling you suck, they're always like, hey, somebody had a few too many that night. You're like, no, I was fucking nervous. Does it ever cross your mind? My hands were shaking because I was nervous, not because I'm a fucking coke addict.
Yeah. Well, people also assume that everything I've ever done or written, any movie or anything I've done, wasted. And it's like, that's the last fucking thing I want to do is like pound a couple cocktails and be like, who's got a laptop? Let's make those keys dance and create some cinema. I don't want to fucking write.
How would I say that exact sentence?
What the fuck? What?
Now I'm a Scottish deaf guy?
Yeah. Scottish deaf.
Now, how are you going to work in the cat? Hold on a sec. Almost like you have Tourette's. A little improv. A little sketch comedy. I'm going to be the cop pulling you over. And I want you to just be you. You have to rest when the cat noise comes out.
Okay.
You're aware of it.
Okay.
Or is it funny if you're not aware of it? You tell me. You're the guy with a sketch show.
Not aware of it.
Okay. Or you at least had a sketch show 16 times.
Yeah.
And then you were like, this is too hard. I want to get back to my roots.
It wasn't too hard. I just didn't want to do it anymore.
The locations are crazy.
It's wardrobe.
Oh, my God. If I get to sit in a VO booth and be a gay robot one more time, I'll kill myself.
Yes.
Hey, can I see your license and registration?
Yeah. Hold on one second.
Excuse me?
What? Yeah. Sorry. I got to get out of the glove compartment.
Can I can see him, please?
Yeah. Yeah, just let me get it. All right. Yeah, here you go. This is so dumb, dude.
Do you know how fast I caught you? How did you think that's dumb?
Did you get in trouble for that?
What?
What?
Get in trouble for what?